hard to let you go. In the Father's hands we know that a lifetime's not too long to live as friends.
And left to die. Oh, raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted, carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and still can fill with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, Then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, and live. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus. Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live.
I've spent my life building castles of dreams, reaching for each distant star. As tears clear my eyes, I finally realize happiness is where you are, and I'm still a part of you. I swear I'll always celebrate your memory. You live inside of me. Heaven holds the ones I love. I see your eyes twinkle in the skies above. My hopes are floating in the clouds. The wind repeats your name out loud. Oh, heaven holds the ones I love. At times I'm unsure why our hearts must endure all the pain, such great loss. Still look what I've gained. I feel your kiss in the rain, but it's your smile I miss the most, and I'm still a part of you. And you're still the biggest part of me. And disbelief, one thing I know is true.
After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Thank you. You are in the Sahara Desert, and you are nowhere close to anybody. In fact, you're about ready to die of thirst. You're dehydrated, the sun is coming down, there's nobody around anywhere. And as you go over the next sand dune, you see somebody, there's an RV there, and you have no idea why an RV would be out in the middle of the Sahara Desert, but it is. And so you're thinking perhaps it's a mirage, but you go over to it, and there's some guy out there, and he has barrels and barrels of this stuff. Hint. The reason I put this up here, I would rather drink motor oil than drink this. This stuff is water, and it says water infused with blackberry essence. My wife bought some of this, wondering what it would be like. It is still at home. It doesn't taste like water. There's not enough blackberry in it to make it taste like a blackberry. It's just like water that has something in it. There's just a hint, as they say. As I said, I would rather drink motor oil. And so if I'm there in the Sahara Desert, and I'm saying this in jest, of course, I can almost see, can you imagine a person, and the person says, well, I got nothing but hint. You want some. Now, if you're dying of thirst and you're dehydrated, you would drink motor oil. You'd most certainly drink that. But can you imagine that the person would say, no, thank you. I'd rather have needles stuck in my eyes than drink that. I'm going to keep going, seeing what I can find. And so you drop back down to the ground, and you kind of crawl off. And of course, we look at somebody like that, and we would think they're an absolute fool. Because if you're dying of thirst, anything would be better than nothing. Who in their right mind would turn that down? I can a little bit understand, because I don't like that stuff. Nobody would turn something like that down. You know, but that's kind of what happens in life. God offers us life. And how many people say, I don't want that. I would rather look for something else. I'll take my chances that over the next hill, they're going to have Pepsi and I can drink that. People who refuse the Lord, who refuse God's offer of forgiveness, basically that's what they're doing. They don't want what God's offering. They want something else, thinking they're going to trade up. You know, the Bible says that we're all born in sin. Now, it's easy to blame Adam and Eve because they were the first two people there. But we don't want to blame them too much because not only have I been born in sin because of Adam and Eve's sin, I have done a lot of things on my own and I've chosen to do wrong, and so have you. And so we're not only part of a sinful human race, but you and I have chosen sin as well. We're dying spiritually, so to speak. Actually, we're already spiritually dead, you could argue, because we are. And the only chance we have to be forgiven is when you and I accept Jesus Christ, accept the forgiveness, obviously, that he offers. Now, we laugh at the person who would turn down the hint, but yet many times the very same people who would laugh at that fool for turning down water that could save his life, they have refused Jesus Christ as their Savior. And they're just going to continue through the desert and they are going to die. Who would be so stupid to choose death over life because they don't want to drink that? Well, in the same way, who would be so foolish that they would refuse Jesus Christ when he offers forgiveness? It doesn't say very much good about their decision-making process. You know, today we're talking about forgiveness, and there's two things in this passage. It talks about forgive us our debts, as I like the way the King James phrases that. I like the way the King James is a more poetic, that's why we're using it for this sermon series. Forgive us our debts. Forgive us for the sins we've committed against God. And then the next part of that, as we forgive our debts, as we forgive those who trespass against us, which is how we normally say it. So we're to seek forgiveness from God, and we're also to offer forgiveness to others. And you see there that part of it. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, when you think about it, it should be easy to seek forgiveness. It should be easy to offer forgiveness, but for some reason it's not. Why are we so resistant to seek forgiveness from God? I mean, why is it when God offers us this, we say, I don't want it. I'd rather walk through the desert and die of thirst than drink that. And in the same way we say, I would rather spend eternity in hell than repent of my sins and ask Jesus Christ to forgive me. It makes no sense. We laugh at the water, be it how many people in our communities, they say the very same thing. Oh, I won't accept Jesus Christ. I'd rather be dead in my sins than do that. Who would choose death over life? Well, sadly, that happens a lot more often than we want to think. And so the first part of that question is, why do we hesitate to seek God's forgiveness? It should be a natural thing. When you think about what God offers us, who in their right mind would turn that down? Almighty God sends His Son to die on a cross for us. And all you and I have to do is not to earn it, but to simply believe on Jesus Christ, to repent of our sins, to ask Jesus to change us. We're giving everything and giving up basically nothing. And yet, how many people don't do that? Why do people hesitate? I mean, God is holy. And He wants us to be forgiven, but why do we hesitate to do that? Who would say no to what God is offering us in Christ Jesus? And it says in Psalm 103, verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far He removes our transgressions from us. Now, the east and the west, it doesn't, you can keep going in either direction forever. It's an infinite amount of distance between the two. What that verse is saying is when we accept the Lord, every sin that we've ever committed, God just doesn't bury it. He removes it so far, they're infinitely apart. It's never to be found by us again. It's gone. Everything we've done wrong, all the regrets that we have, all the things we wish we wouldn't have done, they're gone. I mean, that is good news. Because if you're like me, you've done a few things in your life that you wish you wouldn't have done. You've done a few things you're ashamed of. You've done some things you hope nobody ever finds out about. God takes our sins and removes them as far as the east is from the west. Perhaps the most famous verse in the Bible, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that everyone who believes in Him may not perish, but have eternal life. It's that simple. By believing in Jesus, I pass from death to life. By believing in Jesus, I have eternal life. And yet, how many people turn that down? I think there's several reasons why people say no to eternal life, so to speak. Number one is they want to keep control of their lives. You know, it's interesting. In churches, I'm sure the numbers are right today. They've pretty much been right since the beginning of time. Us men have done fairly bad as a group in the kingdom of God. Every church I've ever served has more women. In fact, it's interesting, if you go back through the history of the church was about 75-80% women, and it had all male leadership. There's more women in leadership today, but the church has always been an organization that has been dominated by women. And so us men have not done very well. We have not stepped up to the plate. And I think part of the reason for that is us men want to do what we want to do, and nobody's going to tell us what to do. I'm not going to drink the hint. I don't care if I die of starvation. I'm not going to do it. I'm a man. I'm going to be in charge of myself. And not just men, but even women in that sense. We want to keep control of our lives. It keeps us from being the people that God wants us to be. The second thing is, we're afraid of what we will become. I mean, if I give my heart totally to Jesus, I don't know what He's going to ask me to do. I don't know who He's going to ask me to become. I don't know what He wants me to do, but I'm just sure it's going to be something that I don't want. And if you think that, if you fall into the trap of believing that lie from Satan, you'll never become the person God wants you to be, because you'll always be hesitant. What if it's not as good as I heard? What if you ask him to do something? What if I have to do this and I just don't want to do that? And so we're afraid of giving ourselves to the Lord, because what if God asks us to be or to do something that we don't want to become? And also, I believe there's these people who are proud of America. They know they're choosing the wrong thing, but they do it anyway because they're going to do what they're going to do. But there are people who hesitate. Now, before you and I criticize those people out there, how often have you and I not surrendered our lives totally to God because we're afraid we'll become something that we just don't want to become? God gives us eternal life. All we have to do is believe on His Son and to trust Him. It's a better deal than we could ever possibly imagine. And yet, people tend to hesitate all the time. So we tend to hesitate in seeking forgiveness from God, but we also tend to hesitate in offering forgiveness to others, especially those people who have hurt our loved ones. You know, I'm pretty easy going. If you hurt me, I can get over that pretty quickly. If you hurt my wife or my children, well, that's a different matter. That's hard. If when I see people from foreign countries burning American flags, every part of me, because I'm very patriotic in that sense, every part of me wants to knock them into next week. I don't do that. But that's how I feel. It's harder to forgive people. It's one thing to seek forgiveness from God, but the Lord says in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, it's interesting. After Jesus gives the Lord's Prayer, his first commentary on the Lord's Prayer, the Lord's Prayer is found in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. The first commentary he gives after the prayer is over is about forgiveness. He doesn't talk about hallowed be thy name. He doesn't talk about give us this day our daily bread. The first thing he talks about are these two verses. He just closes the Lord's Prayer and he says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Okay, that is a powerful statement. The one that I don't think often we think about as much as we should. If you're praying for God to make you the person He should make you, and you're not willing to forgive somebody else, it sort of sounds like in that verse that God's not going to do what you want Him to do. God's not going to forgive you unless you're willing to forgive others. How do I know that? Because it says it right there. Those are the words of Jesus. Either Jesus was exaggerating, or He was lying, and I don't think it's either of those two, or He meant what He said. And He says if you refuse to forgive another person, your Heavenly Father won't forgive you. It's essential that we become people who forgive. You guys have probably heard of David, the Old Testament. You know, King David. Now, if you could have, there could be like two stories of David's life. You could give a whole list of great things that David did. And you could also give a whole list of some things that David did that he wishes he wouldn't have done. And the one I'm thinking of this morning is the whole episode with Bathsheba. You know, David normally was a king who led his army into battle. Except this particular time, he stayed home. And you know the story. He stays home, and he lives there in the castle, which is probably the tallest building in town. And so he looks out the window, and he says, bathing and she's naked. Now I can imagine if I'm at home and I look out the window and I see my next door neighbor bathing in the backyard, or sunbathing so to speak, and she doesn't have any clothes on. The first thing I should probably do is look aside and close the blinds. David didn't do that. It wasn't so much he saw her. He continued to look, and then he calls for her to come over to the castle. And she can't refuse him because he's the king. And you know the story. He commits adultery with Bathsheba. And the story that she becomes pregnant. She sends a story to David. She sends a message over to tell him that she's pregnant and it's David's child. I can only imagine David's mindset when he looks at that note. You're the dad. I mean, David would have known he's in major trouble, but rather than repenting, David comes up with a way to fix it. He says, yeah, if I call her husband Uriah, he's out there in the field fighting, I'll call him home. He'll spend the night with his wife. Everybody will think it's his baby. End of story. So that's what he does. Uriah, however, he doesn't have a lot written about him in the Bible, but he's one of the most honorable men there is in the Bible. His comment is this: how can I possibly go to see my wife when the army of the Lord is out fighting and the Ark of the Covenant is out there? How can I possibly, where they're out there doing that, how can I possibly go see my wife? And so he doesn't go see her. David even tries to get her drunk. That doesn't work. And so David takes his plan a little farther. What's he do? He strikes a note. He trusts Uriah. He gives Uriah the letter to take back to the commander of the army. And he's carrying his own death orders. And what happens is Uriah is put in a hard part of the fight. When that happens, the rest of the army pulls back. Uriah is left there by himself, and he dies. And David has a celebration for Uriah, probably says great things about him. And then to honor Uriah, David says, as the king, I will marry his wife. I'll make sure that this hero's widow is taken care of. And so now his plan is complete. He marries Bathsheba. The child is born. He's thinking, I've got away with this. He's probably thinking, I'll do better the next time. I'm not going to do this again. But I'm thankful I got away with it. So about a year later, God has a plan. Only people in the land who know is David and Bathsheba. About a year later, the prophet comes in, tells David a story about a rich guy who's lost up. Poor guy wasn't that much. Rich guy takes the poor guy's one thing. David said, that guy. The prophet says, you're the man. Because God knew him. David repents, truly repents. And in Psalm 51, we see David, he gives a number of verses there about repentance. But he gives this verse, which is an interesting verse. He says, against you, he's talking about God. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. David is an adulterer. David is a murderer. David deceived people. He's a liar. And yet he says here, had Uriah killed, sinned against Bathsheba, sinned against the whole country. But what's he saying? I have sinned against God, and it's as though he's the only one that I've sinned against. All sin is against God in a sense. There's always a vertical dimension to our lives. Punch your neighbor out. It's not just you and your neighbor that have a problem. You have a problem with God. Because it's impossible to mistreat other people and that not involve your relationship with God. There's always a vertical dimension. Sin. All sin is against God. How do I know that? Because it says that in Psalm 51. David said, wrote those words under inspiration. The reason I'm saying that is because when we don't forgive people, the Bible in numerous places talks about unforgiveness as being a sin. So when I carry a grudge against someone, it's not just me carrying a grudge against that person. I'm sinning against God, because unforgiveness is sin, not just toward that person who hurt me. God wants me to forgive. We don't forgive people because they deserve it. When somebody's mean to you or your family, do they deserve to be forgiven? No. They deserve to burn in hell. They really do. Just as you and I deserve to burn in hell if God was going to, you know, rank our sins the way we've truly committed them. None of us deserve to be forgiven. We all deserve to go to hell forever. That's what we've earned. For the wages of sin is death, is what the Bible says. We deserve to die because of what we've done. It's only by the grace of God that we have been saved. It's not because of any inherent goodness in us. And so, God wants us to forgive people, not because they deserve it, not because they ask. Have you ever seen somebody say, well, I'll forgive them as soon as they ask me? When he asked me, I thought I was doing it for about a week, but I'll eventually forgive him. Don't do that. Forgive when they've done it. When I was in seminary, there was a lady that I ran into. I was a student chaplain at a mental institution right outside of Lexington, Kentucky. One day a week, my mentor year, I would spend 8 hours on Monday there, then on Wednesdays I had 2 hours where we would talk and I'd read some papers about the kind of experiences that I had there at the mental hospital. I ran into this one lady there and I became a friend of hers. It always struck me, why is this lady there? I read her file, she'd been there for about 10 years. And I was thought to myself, how is this lady here? I mean, there were people there that deserved to be there. The one area I was in was the criminally insane, where I learned that if you're going to go to such places, you'd have 2 sets of keys to get in. There was like an area where you go in, they lock the door, you go through that and one other. Had a friend who was knocked down because a guy hit him in the back of the head. So I learned how you pray when you stand next to the wall. You pray with your eyes closed. I mean, these are people who've done things that are for the criminally insane. I saw people there who truly needed to be locked up. But this lady was as sweet as they come. And so one time I was asking her, I asked her, I said, you know, out of curiosity, what happened that put you in here? And it was as though this sweet lady, all of a sudden, her hair jumped up. Her head spun around and green stuff started to come out. She says, my ex-husband. And right away I could tell there was a story coming now. She said, that bleepity bleepity bleep, he cheated on me and he left me for his young secretary. He said, I found out about it on a Friday, and they put me in here on a Sunday. Now, I don't have a PhD in psychology, but I'm smart enough to know if that happened on a Friday, and she's institutionalized on a Sunday, that probably has something to do with why she's been in the mental institution for 10 years. And so after she, her head spun around some more, and green stuff came out, and she said some more bleeping bleeps about her ex-husband. And I looked at her and I said, you need to forgive him. Because it was my last day there, so I thought I got nothing to lose. You need to forgive him. I'll never forgive him. I hope he burns in hell. He deserves to die. I mean, she was just off the deep end. And so I'm thinking, I got my last day. I said, do you think you're hurting? And she said, what do you mean? I said, do you think he lays in bed at night thinking about you? Or do you think he's laying in bed tonight thinking about the young wife? I said, do you think he's worried about you? And then started to hit her then a little bit what was going on. I said, he doesn't worry about you. I said, if anything, your being in here probably tells him that he made a good choice. I said, you have hated him for 10 years, and what have you done to him versus what have you done to yourself? You've been in a mental institution for 10 years. He's out there living a good life with some young woman. I said, you need to forgive him. I'll never forgive him. I'll never let it go. I said, do you think God is going to let it go? What he did? Until he finds forgiveness from God, do you think God's going to let it go? I said, no. You need to let it go because it's for you. Forgiving someone else doesn't forgive the other person's sins. When Jesus was on the cross and he said, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. Do you think God all of a sudden took their sins and wiped them out? No. As a human, the human part of Jesus was forgiving their sins. He was passing it on. But God doesn't forgive sins until the person, I can't forgive your sins, no matter how many times I say it, and vice versa. We can only find forgiveness for our own sins. When you forgive someone, they're not off the hook. Because I think we hesitate, we're thinking, I don't want to let them off the hook. As long as I hate them, they're paying. No, they're not. You've been in a mental institution, so to speak, since that time happened. They're not worried about you. We need to forgive and turn them. All human forgiveness is turning them over to God. I no longer hold them accountable to me. But they will still be accountable to God. And if they don't seek forgiveness, they will pay for what they have done. But they won't pay you. You've probably heard this phrase before. Not forgiving someone is like eating rat poison. And you're waiting for the rat to die. Who's dying when you don't forgive? You are. Not them. And so Jesus said, told us to, that we need to have our debts forgiven from God. And we need to forgive our debts. My friends, close your eyes for a moment. Think to yourself, is there anyone that I am holding it against them? Somehow I'm punishing them, at least that's what I think I'm doing. But I'm not. I've eaten the rat poison. I'm waiting for them to die, and all I've done is I've hurt myself. Father, I pray for each of us here this morning. And for whatever person you're thinking of right now, or for such a person, turn them over to God. God will judge them as He judges each of us. But don't put yourself in a prison because of what somebody else has done. We pray these things in the name of Jesus.